Welcome to TalkNorth.com. Thanks to our longtime producer, Brandon Morton. Please download before you listen. If you'd like to advertise with us, you can reach us at TalkNorthPodcast@gmail.com. And please follow us on Twitter at TalkNorthPod. Two promo codes to be aware of. BiteSquad.com, use the promo code TalkNorth to get your first delivery free. And go to SodaStick.com, the great local apparel company. Use the promo code YouBetcha to get free shipping on any sized order.
Viking-Packer week, and Jeff, I'm conflicted. I don't know if this is one of those big, momentous Viking-Packer games or a game that really doesn't mean a whole lot in the likely playoff scenarios, but let's get into that. Let's get into the Viking running backs, Adam Thielen coming back, Danielle Hunter's play. We'll talk about the Browns and some NFL topics. This is Jeff Diamond's Vikings and NFL Insider, part of the TalkNorth.com podcast network. Please follow us on Twitter at TalkNorthPod. We're putting out some new shows. We're going to be adding more new shows in the new year as we grow and expand the network. Latest show we've added is our Gopher Sports show with Marcus Fuller and Ryan James. They're going to cover all Gopher Sports. Of course, right now they're emphasizing basketball, and they're also very good on high school recruiting and other things. And thank you to our sponsors, White Bear Lake Superstore and B-52 Burgers and Brew. All right, so how should I think about this Vikings game? Because it feels like a big game. And I guess in terms of mathematical probabilities as far as the playoffs, it's not that big a game.
Well, I think anytime the Vikings and Packers play, it's a big game, regardless of what the records are. But I think it takes on more magnitude when both teams are potentially playoff bound. And of course, depending on what happens with the Rams and 49ers on Saturday night, if the 49ers beat the Rams, then the Vikings clinch before they even take the field on Monday. And so we'll see how that plays out. First of all, if the Rams win that game, then I think it puts a lot more pressure on the Vikings to beat the Packers and get in and not have to depend on beating the Bears in the finale, which I think would make everybody very nervous.
Yeah.
With the Bears having nothing to play with but having recent success against the Vikings. So obviously that Rams 49ers game is key, but even if the 49ers win and the Vikings clinch, I think it's still important for the Vikings to make a statement, continue their undefeated season at home, first of all, and to be able to beat the Packers, who they had lost to in a tough fashion earlier this year in Lambeau, and then even the next week against the Bears, to beat the Bears, who have had their number for the last couple of years. And I think those two games take on really big importance, not only this season, but going forward potentially in the race next year. And I think you also have to look at if, for example, the Vikings win out those two games and Seattle beats San Francisco in the finale, then the Vikings can get into the fifth seed, which I think is advantageous to face potentially a Dallas or Philadelphia as opposed to going to Lambeau, even though I think they could win in Lambeau, but you have the weather issues and all those type of things and Aaron Rodgers in the playoffs at home. And so I think the Vikings would rather take their chances going to Philadelphia or Dallas, right, as opposed to having to take on Green Bay in Green Bay, if that is indeed the scenario. Because I'm not counting on the Detroit Lions to knock off the Packers in the last game of the season, but it'd be nice to have that potential opportunity there too for the Vikings to win the division. But very doubtful that the Lions can beat the Packers. They put Stafford on IR, and that's going to kind of kill their chances, and they've lost seven straight or whatever. But I still think it's a big game. It's Monday Night Football, national TV, and the Vikings want to make a statement that they're a force to be reckoned with in the upcoming playoffs.
And I'm going to be fascinated to see how their cornerbacks play in this game. The cornerbacks, you know, didn't have to do a whole lot against the Lions. They got torched early against the Chargers, but then the pass rush started, you know, working more effectively and hid some problems. I'm really interested to see how Devontae Adams and the kind of young group of Packer receivers do against this group. Reminder, if you're new to the network or new to the show, Jeff's former Vikings general manager, former NFL executive of the year, and former president of the Tennessee Titans when they almost won a Super Bowl. And again, you can find all of our shows at talknorth.com, and you subscribe to your favorite podcast app and check out our shows pretty much everywhere. So, you know, this is the kind of thing I don't care a whole lot about, but fans care a lot about. So let's get to the Pro Bowl. You know, when I used to cover the team as a beat writer, a lot of players would ask me to fill out their ballot. So I've never taken the whole Pro Bowl thing very seriously. A lot of players don't even want to play in the game. They just want the honor. But you did have two players who are having very good seasons, Kirk Cousins and Eric Kendricks, not make the Pro Bowl. Do you think they should have?
I think they, yes, I would answer yes in that regard. I think they should have. I think that Cousins, you could argue, well, Drew Brees is Drew Brees, but he missed whatever 5-6 games this year, which I think maybe perhaps should have knocked him down a little bit. And Russell Wilson obviously belongs, and yes, he's a starter. But Aaron Rodgers has had just kind of a mediocre season for Aaron Rodgers. Now, he does have whatever 24 touchdowns and 2 interceptions, but his rating is not near what Cousins is. His completion percentage is not there. And so I guess you could argue that, hey, it's about name recognition. It's about who the players are oftentimes for the Pro Bowl. And I think that hurts Cousins in that regard. And he did make the Pro Bowl once in the past. And he could still get in potentially if, for example, if Seattle ends up in the Super Bowl and Russell Wilson can't play in the Pro Bowl. And that can open up a spot and could open up a spot for Kendricks potentially if Bobby Wagner, for example, doesn't get in. But I think Aaron Kendricks is the bigger snub to me, that he is such a big part of this Viking defense, and I think he had his best season, career high in tackles he's on pace for, and just makes so many plays in the passing game. We saw that last week against the Chargers, covering Austin Eckler, who the week before had over 100 yards receiving and really kind of shut him down in the passing game and the running game, the Vikings did, which was a big part of the victory to be able to handle him and Melvin Gordon, who coughed it up twice, and Kendricks, a huge part of that defensive effort that caused 7 turnovers in the game and helped the Vikings get a really important victory last week and last Sunday in San Diego or in LA against the Chargers. So we still want to say San Diego, don't we? No, it's LA.
It's really San Diego. They're just temping in Los Angeles.
That's right. At Rocket Field or whatever it was. And
which was, by the way, it was a great, I know it's not a football stadium and it's not a big league football stadium. It was a blast though. It's palm trees, intimate. We're sitting in an open-air press box with 50-yard line across from the Vikings sideline, and I could hear Viking players calling to their teammates on the field, and it was mostly Viking fans. It was actually a blast to be there. It's the last game we'll ever see there, right, but it was a blast.
Yeah, it sounded like it. Looked like that on TV. It looked like there were a ton of Viking fans there, which they've traveled really well this year, which is a big boost for the team, certainly. And I'm sure there'll be a few Packer fans that'll sneak into the U.S. Bank Stadium on Monday night also, but the Vikings hope they can drown them out like they did last year. And I think the Vikings have won now, I want to say, 3 or 4 years in a row at home against the Packers and hope to continue that streak. But yeah, I thought that particularly, I thought Cousins deserved to make it, and in particular, I thought Kendricks was a guy who should have. And I think the problem there is they only take 2 inside linebackers for the Pro Bowl team, which I think is kind of a travesty. When so many teams play 3-4, that if you only take 2 inside linebackers, that just doesn't make sense to me, that there should be 3 outside linebackers and only 2 inside linebackers. There should be 3 at each position, and if that had happened, then I think Kendricks would have been the 3rd guy in. And Luke Kuechly, what kind of year has Carolina had? They've been really kind of awful lately. And again, that's a name recognition deal that he gets in. And you talk about other guys. Anthony Harris has had a really excellent season and potentially could have made it. Anthony Barr, so-so, perhaps, and maybe deservedly did not make it this year, but I would have hoped that Kendricks would have made it in his place.
Yeah, the tough thing is, as you said, only taking 2. Kuechly, I don't know how good a year he had. Wagner, I think, had a great year.
Yeah, he's a great player.
Yes. Kuechly's a great player who I'm not sure had a great year. I think that's where Kendricks probably should have slid in there.
Yeah, and I would agree with that, definitely. And I think just the fact that I was thinking about this, just the fact that Kirk Cousins is in the conversation,
I know,
for a Pro Bowl quarterback,
I know,
who would have thought that would have been the case back in week 4?
I know. It's amazing how much has happened.
He's coming off that terrible start and the loss to the Bears and the Packers on the road. And again, we circle back to how important is this game. I think it's important to Kirk Cousins.
I think it's really see, that's where I would go. Whether or not it ends up being important in terms of seeding or making the playoffs, whatever else, this is a chance for Cousins to follow up two and a half months of really strong play in a game where they might not have the running game they tried to build around with Thielen back. This might be the game where Kirk Cousins gets to go out and show off a little bit and kind of erase the storyline that has been hounding him for years now.
Yeah, and that Monday night record of his, it I think is still, what, 0-8 now after losing in Seattle. And so he did get a primetime win in Dallas and got a primetime win over the Redskins this year. So he's won a couple of primetime games, but that Monday night record is still kind of an issue. So I'm sure he would like to erase that stigma off his record too come Monday night against the Packers. And I think it shapes up as a really interesting matchup. I think, Jim, you look at Green Bay, they don't really jump out at you stats-wise.
No.
And they're 22nd in offense, which is way down for an Aaron Rodgers team. They're 23rd in total defense, 24th against the rush, which could be the advantage the Vikings could have. And remember back in September, Dalvin Cook rushed for 154 yards, and Alexander Mattison added 25. The Vikings had a tremendous day, 194 rushing yards in that game. So you got to think going in that that's what Kevin Stefanski's thinking about. Let's pound the ball, establish the run. But is Cook going to be ready to play? Is he going to be at full strength? Is Madison going to be ready to play? He's coming off an ankle. Mike Boone was pretty impressive as a number three back last week with 2 touchdowns and 56 yards rushing. But I'm sure they'd like to have all their top guys in there for this big game on Monday night. And I think the one thing that you look at Green Bay and what's the impressive thing about them, it's a plus 14 turnover ratio. And so that's where they don't turn the ball over. They only have 9 giveaways this season. As we said, Rodgers, 2 interceptions. And meanwhile, 23 takeaways and 15 interceptions. So that's where the Vikings have to be careful. Meanwhile, the Vikings' turnover ratio took a nice jump against the Chargers when they went from plus 5 to plus 11 in one day.
Yeah, and let's talk about Danielle Hunter and the defense and a few other factors that will play into this Vikings-Packers game. Do want to thank White Bear Lake Superstore, whitebearlakesuperstore.com. Also want to thank our longtime producer, Brandon Morton. He's out sick. Hope he gets better. And he's the person who's going to be editing this, so if anything goes wrong with the show, even if he's sick, you can still blame him. But let's thank White Bear Lake Superstore, whitebearlakesuperstore.com.
Yeah, Brandon, you got to suck it up, and you can do it. We know you can do it. We appreciate it.
That's an NFL general manager trying to talk his star player back onto the field.
That's right, exactly there. Right, exactly right. And by the way, happy holidays to everybody. And the White Bear Lake Superstore Buick GMC also says happy holidays. And my longtime friend, the owner, Paul Rubin, his general manager, Charlie Guttrell, their great staff, Minnesota's number one volume Buick GMC dealer, 5 years running with the best selection and the only place to get the premium experience. And if you check out that great website, whitebearlakesuperstore.com, you'll see some great specials, and which include $3,000 purchase allowance on select 2020 Buick Enclaves, $5,500 purchase allowance on select 2019 Buick Encore, and a $5,000 purchase allowance on a select 2019 GMC Acadia, and here's a big one, $8,500 purchase cash on select 2019 GMC Sierra 1500. And the White Bear Lake Superstore Buick GMC also is the Quigley 4x4 Van Superstore. They're a certified elite dealer. Only 7% of GM dealers make the cut. So visit in person at 3900 Highway 61 North in White Bear Lake or online at whitebearlakesuperstore.com for all your vehicle needs and the premium experience. Buick GMC, we are professional grade. And you can shop pre-owned specials on one lot, thousands in savings, the White Bear Lake Superstore, Buick GMC.
So Danielle Hunter had quite a game. I really feel like he won that game for them. They were, you know, Rivers is having a good time on third down. The Chargers are in scoring position. Danielle Hunter punches out one ball, probably 6 to 10 point swing there. Then he, punches out another ball and ends up being the lead blocker downfield on a long touchdown that really turned the game. So you have the perspective. You've been around great players like John Randall. what do you make of Danielle Hunter? What's his place in the game, and what's his potential place in NFL history at this point?
Yeah, he's phenomenal, really. And I think that one thing that Mike Zimmer has constantly said is that it's only the tip of the iceberg where he can go talent-wise. And